That's nuts.
Yeah.
That's
crazy.
I think Claude, you had a lot of retirements. A lot of people retired early. I think it's another key thing too.
Big part of the population. Mm-hmm. Boomers are collecting Social Security from 62 to 70 right now. Mm-hmm. They're collecting it. But if we get big layoffs, because companies are not Procter & Gamble, General Foods, if we're getting layoffs now, and people, they bought their $1 million condo, oh, it's just going to keep going up in price, and I just have to refinance it, and I can always borrow money from mom and dad, right? And they're laid off, and they can't make those $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000 or more per month payments. Mm. What's going to happen? What we were talking about before, is that foreclosure rate going to start to go up?
Short sales and foreclosures.
Is the government going to interfere with the moratoriums again, like they did in the COVID thing? Remember that? That really annoyed the hell out of me. The moratorium on evictions and foreclosures. Do you think we're going to come back to that? I do not believe that's going to happen. Mm-hmm. I hope it doesn't. Mm-hmm. Anybody's thoughts on that? Okay.
The good side of me once says, I hope they do something for those people because they kind of caused it. But then the other, you know, investor side is like, I hope they don't play with it.
So we're going to see layoffs. When we see layoffs, people, and there are jobs out there, Jessica, but then maybe they're not the six-figure jobs. And people can't make these principal, interest, taxes, insurance, homeowner fee. These are have you guys seen?
Yeah, of course.
Hey, Claudia, what was our first mortgage payment in the Stone Age?
When we get out of the shower.
I don't know. $800-$900 a month, I think, for our first house. Okay. And everything. What do you guys know what people are paying today for mortgages in Phoenix and stuff like that? Brandon, what do you think? What do you think a young or middle-aged couple is paying per month? What portion of their income is going to that?
So just rents. So give you an idea. Rents have gone up like crazy, Claude. And I know this because I have a 22-year-old daughter that went to go rent an apartment. And then she went back the next week and they already bumped it up like $100 or $150. So rents are going up like crazy. Just a one-bedroom apartment in our area is going for like $1,700. A two-bedroom is like over $2,000.
A man called me up this weekend, a grown man in his early 50s, and he's making $100 to $200 a night delivering Domino's pizza.
Wow.
Okay, so, I mean, you know, and I respect hard work, okay, and whatever his situation is. How does that guy afford that kind of rent if he's making $700 to $1,000 a month, a week? Can he still afford all that stuff? I mean, how much of your income can go to your rent or your mortgage?
The mortgage companies like to look at no more than, 37%?
Yeah. Is it that high? Is it that high now? It used to be 25 in the Stone Age.
About a third of your income can go towards housing.
Okay. So are people really spending a third, or are they spending 50%, 60, 75% of their income towards their housing?
How's it going?
I'm sorry, go ahead.
In California, a lot of people are spending 50% or more of their income on rent.
Yeah. And is that going to go up or come down? I think it's going to go up. Yeah. I think rents are, my daughter lives in LA. She just bought a new place. She still has her old apartment because the rent is so reasonable. I think it's $1,500, $1,600 a month. She said,
Dad, I'm going to be a contrarian.
Okay.
I think that rents will keep going up and then we're going to hit a peak and then they're going to go back down. Because here in Phoenix, whenever we had foreclosures, people would move out of a house and move into a rental house. They were paying, say, $1,500 for their mortgage on their PITI, and then they would move into another house for rent for $700 or $800.
Yeah. Supply and demand is going to take, I'm not going to disagree with you there, Brandon. I think supply and demand is definitely going to have an effect. But did you remember the expression back in 2008, chasing the market down? Has anyone ever heard that expression?
Yeah.
How many people thought, well, my property, I waited a long time for it to get to this price, and I don't care how much it goes down, I'm going to keep my price until reality sits in, and the home, who remembers the drop? Vegas had the most spectacular drop. I think 50% wasn't it, Jessica or Henry? What was the, when it was all said and done, didn't Vegas have a 50% drop in price, in prices?
I seen some down to 60, Claude. It was really? Pretty big.
Wow. How about in Fresno?
You know, Fresno's kind of an unusual place. It's probably one of the cheapest places to live in California. And they're also about 9 months to a year behind, but we had about a 25%, you know, correction. I know that. You know, LA and San Francisco are typically the leaders, you know, in San Diego too, in the price reduction.
So here's a statistic for you, Claude. 37%, the home prices have increased in the last 2 years, 37% nationwide.
Right.
37% nationwide.
And how fast are they gonna go? How fast are they gonna go down?
If they go down, if we have a 50% drop in Phoenix, Arizona, our prices go back to just 2 years ago.
We're going to see some, we're going to have to see eventually an adjustment. Go ahead, Jessica.
I have a question for Claude and the group. If someone is pulling money out of their retirement fund, their IRA, and that's the stock market and investing into real estate, does anyone have a good idea of the best timing for that?
Who has a crystal ball? Where's that eight ball? Who has a magic eight ball on their desk? Somebody get that thing.
Come on,
you got to buy a magic eight ball. Jan Guzman, you got an eight ball in that truck somewhere, don't you?
How much further will the stock market fall is the question. And then how much further will the properties values fall? I'm saying between now and 6 months, maybe is a good time. I don't know.
Go ahead, Brandon.
If you have a big amount, I would check out self-directed IRAs and do a rollover. And then you can basically write a check to your investment. Self-directed IRAs.
Where it's transferred right directly
from your regular 401k or regular IRA.
It's an IRA and a 401k. But
Henry, it's not me, it's for someone else. They're like, because Henry probably deals with a lot of private lenders.
Does anyone here ever follow Bruce Norris? David Skolnick, talk about Bruce Norris is a California. He's an economic statistician. Bruce is brilliant. Every Christmas, he does a major report here in California. He takes California, but he also analyzes the whole country. And he takes the stats of inventory, of prices, of listing times. David, could you talk about that for a second?
I didn't see him last Christmas, but he does use the SDCIA as the main presentation for his new reports. I think he's liquidated a lot of his stuff and he's gone to Florida.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now is a good time to liquidate. But check out Bruce Norris. Bruce is very good. He really publicizes the stats.
He's a stat guy, numbers guy.
To answer Jessica's question, you've got to follow the stats. Right now, the stock market is an emotional bellwether. I don't know if the stock market is almost always the most accurate forecaster. The stock market tends to react prematurely because it's very emotionally based. I mean, it's based on what company profits, what they're declaring. And you're going to start to hear the Wall Street Journal said this and Dow Jones went down 500 points, you know, and everything. Remember, October's coming. What historically, how many historians here follow? What always happens in October?
Isn't it the almanac?
The almanac?
You know, that thing that comes out that...
No, not the not the farmer's almanac.
Stock market takes a dive.
In October...
I'm not a stock market guy.
In October, the stock market has had Black Fridays. We saw it, in 2008. We saw the Great Depression. You know, the stock market's going to react overreact, and it's going to take a dive, and it's going to be in the newspaper, and everybody's going to kind of panic a little bit. And that's exactly when you should not panic and realize that that's when a lot of investors are going to jump in. That's going to be the bellwether of maybe this thing is starting to bottom out to watch that. So October is very interesting to me because historically, I don't know the reason why, maybe somebody can explain it, but October, there's usually a stock market crash when you have this kind of economic thing going on.
Yeah, I think it was Claude. It was October 29th, 1987. Right. And it just all went boom. So it gives away my age a little bit there. But yeah, it was long. Yeah, mm-hmm. So I'm with it.
Who said, if you do not choose to respect history, you will repeat it? Mm-hmm. So Jessica, to answer your question, look at all, go to people who have no other alternative, ulterior motives. Look at people who use stats. I mean, real stats.
Okay.
On them, stock market, inventory, MLS listings,
okay,
and stuff like that. Be careful of a lot of these fatalist gurus that are out there. They come out of the woodwork when this stuff happens. Mm-hmm. You got to be careful. So this is an opportunity right now. We talked about this a couple of weeks ago. This is a time to tighten your belt, to strengthen your credit, to get rid of garbage inventory. If you have any problem tenants, problem properties, this is a time to consolidate and just sit back and wait. Wait for the moment, the magic moment. Okay. You'll see, what's his name? Warren Buffett. Mm-hmm. Warren Buffett always seems to come out during times like this, right? Mm-hmm. You know, start reading the business sections of the Wall Street Journal, of Forbes. Who has a favorite magazine that gives good information? Anybody have a recommendation?
IBD and Barron's.
IBD, yeah. Investor Business Daily, right? I used to read that. I stopped for some reason. Mm-hmm.
Claude, yeah. I think Brandon had a very good point. Know your market, because he said in Arizona, Phoenix, anything under $400,000, that's kind of like a nice little area right there. Anything over $2 million. So know your market. Know where people are actually mm-hmm. buying right now. You still can make money now if you know mm-hmm. your market and you got the money to do it. So just know where you're at. Do your research. Do your homework. And then know the market. Use the gut system. Tell you, I used the gut system, man. I used it, and I used the guts 2.0 just about 3 weeks ago, and I sold a $250,000 three lots out in Maricopa. But I used the guts. I started to learn, ask them where they're at, find out where they're at, and then once I find their emotions, and I use those guts 2.0 to get. And they, I had this one guy. I was selling these three lots, and he was going to buy it. I said, "What do you want to do with it?" "Oh, I want to build a home out there." I said, "Can you imagine for a moment? You're sitting on your back patio. You have yourself a nice hot cup of coffee. Can you smell the coffee? Can you see your beautiful mountain there? Can you see the eagle maybe flying around the mountain? And it's very peaceful. How would you feel about that?" He goes, "I feel great. Where do I send you the money?" So, So once I got that, I quickly said, "Well, let's get a contract. So we got to close. We need a contract." So I gave him till 8 o'clock the next day to get it to me. I said, 8:01 is over. And he got it to me at 8 o'clock, and it was a $250,000 sale, but I brought in the emotions. And that's what I want to say is, it's all about the emotions, man. Once you find out what it is, find out where they're at right now emotionally, and then just use the guts moves to close them.
This is a very emotional time for a lot of people. There's a lot of negativity, a lot of doom and gloom. The sky is falling. People are getting laid off. And this is when you have to put on blinders and you say, "I'm not going to get sucked into that emotional vortex," like Steve just said. "I'm going to look at it and know that we always," and you can mark this verbatim, "we always recover." Mm-hmm. Okay, sooner or later, the politicians get so much pressure, they limit spending, they start cutting the budget. We start seeing people getting a little bit more fiscally conservative. Okay, they're not spending $7 trillion a year on stimulus checks for COVID anymore and things like that. Mm-hmm. They're not unlimited extension of unemployment checks and stuff. You start to see a conservative fiscal nature come about. And when that starts happening, when that culture shift and the politics and the banking starts to happen, 6 months from there, you're going to start to see the recovery. And another point is this is the opportunity to get the good homes in the good neighborhoods.
Right.
Okay. A lot of times when the market is really strong, like it's been for the last couple of years, we go to the shit shack neighborhoods. Okay. Because they're the cheapest properties. We can put in the sweat equity. My opinion is that when you have this kind of economic turmoil, this is exactly the time to get the dream properties, the good homes in the good neighborhoods, the good school districts. Are they the first to recover? Yes. Are they the least? Do they suffer the least downward trend? Yes. These are the properties you want to own that will give you prosperity and security for a lifetime. We're almost out of time. Anybody have great info? Thank you, by the way, Brandon and Henry and Steve.
I wanted to give you one more little tidbit. They said they nailed this over and over. Retail buyers will always be buying. People are always moving. They're always growing families. There's always downsizing. So the retail market will still be a very good part. There's something called novations, or back in the day, they would just use options, and you just get something under option and you list it on the MLS. Like, retail is still going to be a huge resource.
Absolutely. Anybody have a quick question? We got 1 minute left here. We got a wealth. You guys are great, by the way. I have taken copious notes. This is an opportunity. Don't look at the doom and gloom. Who's got a question before we run out of time?
I got a statement, more of a statement. If you can get a line of credit, do it now, because the HELOCs are still available. In another 4 or 5 months, the HELOCs might not be available. So if you can get a line on your house, you've got the cash. If your house is free and clear, or even if it isn't, get a line of credit so you got some money to tap into.
Home equity line of credit. If you're doing if you're doing your banking, Mission Federal Credit Union, Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Bank of the West, this is the time. You don't have to use it, by the way, but it's there. If you've got a house with $100,000, an investment property, $100,000 equity, and you can get a $50,000 line of credit, and then all of a sudden you're seeing a nice lot in Scottsdale that went for $180,000, and you now can pick it up for $75,000. This is exactly the time to grab those key properties. They will give you security. They'll pay for your kids' college. They will give you a wonderful retirement. This is the window of opportunity that smart investors also take. Anyone else? Go ahead.
I have a quick question on that subject. Where do you get loans, equity lines like that for investment properties? I have one that I own almost free and clear, but it's a rental. Which banks will give me an equity line? Anything or no?
You have to do your homework, Jessica. Do your homework. Okay. Now, your house, is your house free and clear? Do you live in a house? Is it free and clear?
My condo is not free and clear, but I have a really low loan on it. But this is a rental that I own almost free and clear.
Well, so you could probably still get a second HELOC on your home, on your condo. Use that, I mean, if you needed to. I don't know what it's like with the rentals. You'd have to do your diligence and really make a lot of phone calls. But I think there's a window for about 6-7 months where I think it's going to go, where they're not going to be allowing those anymore. Chase Bank out of Arizona quit doing it. Anyways, Claude, you got to go. So
I could stay on for hours on this topic, but sometimes less is more. Did we learn anything today? Show me. Anybody learn anything?
Yes.
Good stuff. Great information. The wealth is in the knowledge and experiences of the people in this room. Okay. If we don't respect history, we serve to repeat it. Learn from successful people, study it, stay on top of financial news, and wait for that window in your marketplace. Wait for that window. And there will be, and the one thing we haven't had, and I'm going to use language here. What's the one thing every guru at every seminar says? Find the motivated seller. Have we had motivated sellers the last 12 years? No, yeah. When the prices are going up, all the sellers are high and mighty, right? What are we going to see over the next 6 to 18 months? Motivated sellers. People have lost their jobs, can't make the payments. They're in foreclosure. They're moving to lower income, places for rent and stuff like that. This is exactly the time where you, if you plan, like Steve said, your credit, okay, and hold back your money. Maybe hold back that vacation that you've been thinking of to Hawaii. Maybe now is the time to save that $5,000 rather than spend it. And you turn that $5,000 into $500,000, something like that. Everybody, give yourselves a round of applause. Great session. Thank you so much. Have a good, safe week, okay?